600 spot on your dial. WICC, Bridgeport, Connecticut.
I'm Bud Finch, and I'll be back right after Andy Corona's news. Next, over the sound of New Haven, WELI.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is Bob Steele of WTIC Hartford, speaking to you from the Army's Bradley Field in central Connecticut, where 25 or 30 big four-engine bombers have arrived in the past hour or so. More are coming in all the time.
The latest news from the WTHT Hartford Times newsroom.
Town Hartford, we bring you Hartford Speaks, transcribed. I'm Bob Maher. Here's Una King.
Well, you bright little spring boy, you're anticipating it a little bit, aren't you?
That's number 83, everybody, at WTIC, and I think you're Robinson Countdown Show. As we check out the top 100 records for 1967.
The Ken Griffin Show. WPOP.
From high atop Radio Mountain at 95.7, this is WBMI Hartford, Meriden. My name is Dan Bloom.
Connecticut Radio Memories, a series chronicling the first six decades of Connecticut's radio stations, as told by the people behind the microphones and behind the scenes. Episode 8, Hometown Radio Part 1, stories from radio stations in Connecticut's smaller cities and towns. Bill Hennessey.
WKNB was 840 in the dial, 1,000 watts, very strong signal. Did a lot of Polish programming, did a lot of popular music programming as well.
Welcome to the Rural Hour, presented every evening, Monday through Saturday. These programs are designed especially for rural Connecticut listeners. If these broadcasts meet with your favor, we would appreciate receiving a card from you. And now, here is your farm commentator, Irwin H. Forbush.
Good evening, folks. And we have a real treat for you tonight. We have a group of boys here that are working on the tobacco camps here in the Connecticut Valley. This program is sponsored by the Connecticut Council of Churches, which has been doing a lot of work with those boys during the summer. And we have Levington E. Smith of Washington, D.C., who is musical director for the camps. And Mr. Smith, would you take over now and let us have Swing Low, Sweet Chariot.
Swing low, sweet chariot.
Come on, let me go.
You've been listening to The Rural Hour, presented each evening, Monday through Saturday. The Rural Hour featuring Irwin H. Forbush, our farm commentator, and Gus Brundage, WKNB's farm program director. We invite you to send in any comments or suggestions you feel appropriate. And if you like the program, we would appreciate hearing from you. Address all mail to The Rural Hour, WKNB, New Britain.
K&B was actually, it was owned by a guy that ran an advertising agency, a guy named Julian Gross, and it stood for WK New Britain, and it was in downtown New Britain. It was at 243 Main Street, as I recall, because I remember going over there applying for a job as a copywriter, which I didn't get.
I started working as a radio engineer at the New Britain Broadcasting Company, WKNB. That's New Britain, Connecticut, from January the 11th, 1947, to June the 13th, 1948.
Charles Poticha.
The FCC required that at that time you needed a licensed radio engineer at the transmitter for all broadcast stations. And so my shift was at the transmitter site during my shift, and that was to monitor the transmitter to make sure that it was working within its parameters. And if perchance anything malfunctioned, it was to fix it or correct the discrepancies. And the chief engineer at the station at the time that I worked there was William Atkinson, and he and his family lived at the transmitter building. If I remember correctly, this was the zoning laws because the area was essentially zoned for residential. So the transmitter building was actually a full house with the front room, bedroom, transmitter room, kitchen, etc. The program director's name, as I recall, was Scott, and his nickname was Great Scott. They had a man on the street program. At that time, that was quite popular with both stations, where you would station yourself with a remote on the street, some busy street corner, and question people as they go by, asking them different pertinent questions of what their opinions are, the facts of the day, or what have you. They had the popular one that most stations had was for the housewife, which was usually at the local hotel in the lounge or coffee shop area, where the housewives would gather and they would have some type of variety show, and then crazy hats or what have you, and then they would have some type of contest for small prizes. They did have a KFWB FM station up in one of the mountains.
I started at an FM station over in New Britain. It was WFHA at that time.
Bill Glynn.
Well, actually, at that particular time, I had auditioned over there at WKNB for a baseball job. At that time, the Yankees were doing telegraphic reports. They didn't send their teams on the road, because I'd get the wire report in, and therefore you'd have to add lib around it and present the ball game. So I managed to pass the audition, and then we had a little problem. They decided they couldn't do it, and they offered me to fill in on the FM station on WFHA.
Again, Charles Poticha.
And what they were doing was selling pilot tuners. I think they were about $25 for converters to pick up the FM station. And that the FM program was essentially just a rebroadcast of the AM.
And they had KNB AM, and I'm trying to think of the morning man.
Phil Hale was the big morning man at WKND.
Phil Hale's son, Phil Hale Jr.
Yeah, absolutely. He was up at the crack of dawn, leaving home about 4:30 every morning. Oh, my father fell in love with radio while he was in Trinity College. That was quite a few years ago after coming home from serving with the Yankee Division in World War II. He resumed his college studies and then went to work for WKNB, and he was bit by the radio bug. And the bright 1,000-watt transmitter down in Newington just lit up at 6 o'clock every morning. And it was time for the Phil Hale Show. And remember that my dad's theme song was Hail, Hail, the Gang's All Here, and some of us still are.
Hail, hail, the gang's all here.
What to do to lose them? What to do to lose
them? Hail, hail, we're full of cheer.
What to do to lose them?
And so that cheerful voice that everybody just loved to hear every morning came from Dad as everyone threw their clock radios out the window. No, just kidding. But Dad always maintained a good sense of humor, played the best that he could, did the best he could. Oh, he'd have been playing a lot of Dorsey Brothers and Glenn Miller and Big Band and anything that was popular, because there was actually very little differentiation on radio between musical types.
Phil Hale's daughter, Penny Duborg.
My dad just really enjoyed bringing great cheer to everyone. You know, that was what kept his motor going. And he was fun. He loved improv. He just really wanted to bring spirit to those who listened to him. His goal in life was just to bring cheer to those around him and just show his desire to bring laughter and fun and joy, and he would tease. He just would be on that radio because he just loved to take care of people, and he just wanted their day to just be better. That was his goal.
Again, Bill Hennessey.
Phil Hale was very, very popular on W and against Bob Steele, which was kind of tough competition, because Steele had about 70% of all the ears tuned into radio every morning.
Bob Steele from WTIC Radio was a direct competitor.
But Phil Hale had his share.
Again, Phil Hale Jr.
invented what's called the Thank Heaven It's Friday Club, which I have one of the buttons of. It was a promotion for the station. That Dad's face was on billboards and posters, and they gave out pins and buttons at personal appearances throughout the greater Hartford area. Though WKNB was licensed for New Britain, it was actually located in Newington, just down from the Veterans Hospital.
Rusty Potz.
WKNB, and the name I could think of as a highly identifiable air personality at that time, was a fellow by the name of Jack Cumley, who wound up on Channel 30.
Don Blair.
And Jack Cumley, who was doing sports on TV at night, was a great disc jockey. Funny, very entertaining. And he had an afternoon show on WKNB.
Do you remember any other names of people at WKNB? Fred Swanson.
Oh, Johnny Palmer, Bob Bray. Bob Bray was the general manager at Channel 30 for a while.
But I do know that in 1950, they decided to come up with this newfangled thing called television.
Julian Gross had the foresight that a lot of people in Hartford didn't have, to see that television was the wave of the future. He applied for and received the license for Channel 30 TV, and that became WKNB-TV.
And then it became WNBC, but of course you know what happened then. The big guys in New York said, hey. Then when Viacom came in, it became WVIT.
Again, Phil Hale Jr.
And Dad was the first face and the first voice heard on the first UHF channel in Connecticut, which, of course, was Channel 30, also known as WKNB back then. So they also had a radio station and a television station going at once.
Again, Don Blair.
Phil Hale, who was the news editor who would cut film in those days for the evening newscast, which was only 15 minutes at 7 o'clock with Barry Barents, wonderful man. And Phil was also on the air. He was the morning man. And he was as wry and witty as a radio person could be. And the boss over at KNB was a gentleman named Ralph Klein.
And KNB was UHF, and not a lot of people had UHF antennas. But they did gradually get viewers.
And I've run across a lot of folks in the Hartford area who do remember Dad, mostly from television, where he did the early show. He did Jigsaw Quiz, and my mom played Vanna White for that show, which was kind of fun. And at the prime age of 2 years old, they had a Christmas party, and back then, you know, they were family, and they broadcast the family stuff of the studio. And so I said, ladies and gentlemen, our host for this evening here is Phil Hale. And I walked out from behind a refrigerator. I'll never forget that. And I toddled around and watched the big camera tilt from where Dad would have been down to where I would have been. And we just had fun.
Before it went off the air completely, by the time I got to Channel 30, there was no more WKNB radio. And our newsroom, where we sat and typed whatever we had to write, was formerly the WKNB radio studio. And it was no bigger than your average-sized living room. That was the whole radio station.
When WKNB radio was sold, it vacated its studio at the Channel 30 TV building, which later became WHNB-TV. The radio station then moved back to its studios at the Newington Transmitter site and took new call letters, WRYM. We asked Phil Hale Jr. if he remembered anything about the Newington location.
Oh, sure. Well, the house, like I say, is still there, and it's probably best described as a 2-1 under today's standards, a two-bedroom, one bath. All of the upstairs were offices with storage in the attic, and down on the first floor was the boss's office and the secretary's office and a small kitchenette, because we had to have coffee or we really couldn't keep going, and the one sole solitary bathroom. Down in the basement were the two studios and the announcer's booth. So we had two small control rooms that actually had a board in it, and at that time, cartridge players. We had three cartridge players, a big old huge RCA clock, and two turntables that would take a huge record, about 1.5 times the size of a 33 1/3 vinyl. Everything we did there musically was done on vinyl, and then everything that we did on tape was usually done on Mylar reel-to-reel 7.5-inch tapes.
Yeah.
It was fun. One of my favorites was the day that the air conditioner broke, and of course we're in the basement, and the temperature got so hot that the records would not play. The needle literally stuck into the vinyl, and we managed to get a couple of fans and had to turn the fan off when the microphone went on, and then we had to turn the fans back on until the air conditioner could get fixed. There was one little trap door that went out from the studio into the backyard of the house. And then from the house, there was a wooden structure that went all the way back to the transmitter antenna up on top. And it really was bare bones radio. It was just lots of fun. A lot of college stations probably have better equipment than we had in those days.
Phil Hale's daughter, Penny Duborg.
There was a change in ownership. The call letters were different. My dad was always very, very happy, very even keel. But this one time he did his radio show, but I felt he was concerned about something. So I asked him, I said, Dad, what's wrong? And he told me that it used to be that he could interject emotion to his talking on the radio show. In other words, he could interject a moment of silence if someone had passed away, and it could be somewhat personal. And then times changed, and then the ownership changed. And I think it was more the times than anything. And he was told that he had to no longer give any emotion, that it was just sort of across the board type thing in all radio stations, that no longer you had to just give the news without interjecting any personal feeling in your voice. And he felt, I'll never forget his words, because he said to me, he says, Penny, life is never going to be the same. And it was so profound and hit me so, and it stuck with me ever since.
Rusty Potz.
It eventually switched format to beautiful music. I worked there, too, on weekends for a while. WRYM, Rhyme Radio.
Beautiful music in the air everywhere, WRYM 840. Basically, we turned into elevator music. And Dad decided that, that was okay for him. He was cool with that for a while and decided, well, it's time to bail off the radio. I don't remember the exact year that he quit radio, and it was after I joined the Army in 1969. He and I were both working together there for about a year, year and a half, and he had the morning show still, and it was still the Phil Hale Show. And I had the afternoon show, which was called Serenade, because they decided that, again, they were going to de-emphasize the DJ himself. So we managed to make sure that everybody knew it was me, because Dad would say, hey, Junior will interpret Obla D, Obla Dot tonight on his show, tune him in, and I'd play something similarly innocuous and say, hey, tune into the old guy in the morning, he might be able to figure it out for you. So we teased each other back and forth on the air.
And the program director there was a fellow by the name of Les Ross, a really nice gentleman.
The program director's name was Les Ross. Les was always kind of arrogant, and we were all kind of mischievous. So one day, we decided that we were going to play a joke on Les. Les would do what we call as a rip and read. In those days, the Associated Press and United Press International came in on teletype machines. They were extremely noisy. They were in the basement, too. And you could hear five bells go off. You knew there was a hot story. Well, what Les would do is he would go, and he would literally rip off about 16 feet of the teletype machine, and he'd just sit there running it through his fingers and doing the editing at the same time he was reading it. So one day, to kind of cure him of that and say, hey, look, you know, you really ought to plan ahead, while he was doing that, we snuck in the door and we lit the bottom of it on fire. It was in the days before smoke alarms. And the flames would just kept going up this sheet of paper he was reading from. It got to his fingertips. And he just closed it by saying, that's the latest news, hot off the presses. He had a good sense of humor, too, and he actually made a full newscast out of that.
Ed Henry.
We had a gentleman by the name of Stan Osimek who did a polka show on WRYM, and it was broadcast from the Polish National Home in Hartford.
Stan Osimek, who had a wonderful Polish polka hop show, really loved to have an audience. So what we would do is, the room was, of course, very, very tiny. You'd be lucky to get two chairs in it. And so I would make up voices, and I'd do voice impressions for him. And one of those that we did was the senator, which was very close to Bobby Kennedy's voice. And one day I remember us being on the air and was bantering back and forth, and Stan said, well, do you think you'll run for president? And my response was, well, I'm not sure. If Ethel and the kids will all vote, maybe, you know, we have a chance here. And I got a phone call about 30 seconds later from the Democratic National Chairman, who happened to be from Connecticut. I don't remember the man's name, demanding to know where we got the tape.
Oh, gee.
And it was a lot of fun, because I told him, honest to God, it's just me. It's me messing around. It is nothing else.
Again, Fred Swanson.
WRYM attempted a beautiful music format.
RYM was up to number 4 in the ratings.
The problem was they were not a 24-hour station.
WRCH, which was beautiful music, and they kind of blew the doors off of WRYM when they did that, because as soon as RCH switched to the identical format and went around the clock with it, that kind of murdered WRYM.
So, when we came on the air, they continued with a beautiful music format, and then they decided to go ethnic, which they did, and have been doing that ever since.
And it remains on the air today, primarily as a multilingual station under WRYM. When I worked there, it was just in transition between the multilinguals and the English only. Thanks for listening, and have a great day. And be good to each other. It's grumpy enough out there.
Well, in 1948...
Dick Bertel.
A radio station went on the air in Norwalk, Connecticut, WNLK.
Richard Ward Fatherly.
WNLK was owned by a fellow named James Stoltz at the time. 1350 on the dial. I believe it was 1,000 watts, a regional class 3 frequency, and it had a very good local following. And the program director and chief announcer was Dick Buonerba, an Italian fellow who had a fabulous voice. I used to hear him warm up singing in the record library. They had a very good Edward R. Murrow-esque sounding news director, and I thought that he was quite something. He had a very good delivery and a very crisp style of reporting, and his name was Kurt Gibson. Then they had another fabulous sounding afternoon announcer, very mellow, very network sounding voice, just as smooth as could be, good baritone delivery. His name was Vince Lawford, I believe, and he was quite something on the air.
Again, Dick Bertel.
I was still in high school, and I decided I would go up there and introduce myself and suggest that I would be willing to sweep the place out and so forth. You know, the typical the typical approach that was used in those days to get a job in radio.
Get your foot in the door.
Exactly. I didn't do any sweeping out, but they asked me if I would be interested in hosting a teenage program called The High Teen Show, which was live every Saturday morning from 11:05 to 11:30.
Again, Richard Ward Fatherly.
I became a participant in a Norwalk, Connecticut, WNLK-sponsored program called High Teens with several other high schoolers, and we sold the program to the 7-Up Bottling Company of Norwalk, and we had a wonderful time for an hour every Saturday playing the hits and talking about our school news.
We would have singers and instrumentalists and child actors and so on, and I was the host of that show, and that gave me my introduction to radio. I knew I wanted radio as a career, but I thought, well, maybe I should be a radio writer. Now, there's a field that didn't have much of a future at that time, of course, because of the advent of television. But I did write plays, and they were produced by a community radio workshop on WNLK.
Good evening. It's Friday, January 6th, 1950. This is Bill Edwardson welcoming you to WNLK's Mystery Theater of the Year, produced by the Community Radio Workshop. Tonight we present an original radio drama written by Dick Bertelman of the WNLK announcing staff. Listen now as the WNLK Community Radio Workshop, directed by Bill Morton, presents The House of Retribution.
Say, boss, hadn't you better take it easy? Driving on these strange country roads at night, you better slow down.
Listen, Marty, I'm driving. I don't need any help, you or Gene. Things going all right so far, hasn't it?
Yeah. You know, boss, I can't help thinking what a pushover that job was today. Yeah, just like taking candy from a kid.
Well, that's because I planned it carefully. You know, it's like I told you. Plan a job carefully and nothing goes wrong.
What time is it, Cliff?
It's about 11:45.
I asked Cliff, not you, Marty.
Yeah, well, it's still 11:45.
I'll lay off you two. And listen, Jeannie, you keep your lip to yourself, you understand? I've been driving steady since we pulled that job this afternoon, and I'm tired.
We're all tired. And hungry, too.
Shut up, will you?
Hard to imagine today that a local radio station would produce its own dramas, but WNLK did. They were live. I was there for the broadcasts. I was an observer. But to watch those actors use your lines and bring them to life, so to speak, was very, very exciting.
Recently, WNLK has been an NPR news talk station operated by WSHU in Fairfield.
I was living in Windsor on Bloomfield Avenue with my parents.
Wayne Mulligan.
So I was 20, 21 years old. I had passed all of the elements and had gotten my first-class radio telephone license. And down the street was a small Windsor radio station. At the time, the call letters were WSOR. It was on 1480. So I had the license in my hand. So I got on my bike and I rode down to the transmitter and rode in. And at that time, you had to have somebody on duty at the transmitter all the time you were on the air. So I go in and I knock on the door and the chief engineer was there and I introduced myself and we talked for a little bit. And I said, I got this paper, this license, this FCC license. What should I do with it? And he said, well, let me see it. And he took and looked at it. And he says, I think you should hang it up on the wall right over here. He says, then, on the weekends, you can come down here and work and so forth. So at that point, even though I was still in school, I was working down there on the weekends with the station. So I would go in and sign it on. And being a daytimer, signed on at sunrise. And then stay there and run the transmitter until sign off. So that was how I got into broadcasting.
Yeah. I think my first paid job was at WSOR in Windsor, which was 1480 on the dial. That was 1964 into 1965.
The studios were down on Pequannock Avenue in Windsor, right across from what at the time was Artery Chevrolet. The building's not even there anymore.
Well, I worked at WSOR.
Rusty Potz.
I started there for, I believe it was $1.25 an hour. Went full-time, $65 a week, and a year later, they had me all the way up to $80 a week. The most difficult moment on the air was the first time I ever turned the microphone on to say something. The fellow who was teaching me how to run the board didn't want to get off the board. He was a salesman, and they were using him on the board just as an emergency until he could train me, and he didn't want to go out and sell anymore. He wanted to stay on the air, so he didn't really want me to be very successful. So all I had to do was put a key down that would bring in the mutual network. And then this guy told me, he says, whatever you do, there are thousands and thousands and thousands of people listening to this radio station right now. Don't blow it. Whatever you do, don't blow it. Well, he had me so nervous, my finger was shaking like crazy, and he points at me, now hit the button. I go to hit the button, I miss the button. And he yells, oh my God, you blew it. That was the most difficult moment. WSOR was basically programming. It was very localized as far as the news goes. I remember I used to have to do a newscast from the Simsbury Savings Bank. They did Simsbury News from 10 o'clock weekdays, 10 a.m. until 10:05. So they sent me over there with a little Bogan amplifier, and I would do a Simsbury News from the bank. The rest of the day, most of the day, was a Mutual radio network. Mutual in those days, which was a great old network, used to feed music all day long and newscast at the top of the hour. Then they had the Dick Biondi show for 2 hours in the afternoon. So I did a show for an hour before Dick Biondi and another hour after Dick Biondi, and that was Top 40.
In the mid-1960s, WSOR's call letters changed to WEHW. Then in 1969, WEHW became WKND.
I know they have different call letters, and I think a great R&B format, the last I knew.
Sean Edenburn.
I went to work for WKND. It was a terrific station, working with Lloyd Wimbish, Lou Brown. It was a great station. I stayed there for about 2.5 years. It was soul music.
All right, on WKND.
WKND was an interesting station, and with 500 watts, it didn't get out too far, but it got out far enough to meet their audience. Ken Dawson owned it, and that's why it had the initials of KND for Kenneth Nathan Dawson. Ken was an interesting guy, and he was a first-class engineer, but he was also the station owner manager. The newsroom was out at the transmitter, I think on Bloomfield Avenue in Windsor, and while the DJ studio was across town at the Windsor Mall.
KND, 1480 Windsor! Here's the WKND super sound from the 10 stations, everybody. 3:30 in about Insurance City now. Let's unite the world. 69 degrees on the outside now. I'm the captain, gonna be round.
It was a great station, I loved it there.
Broadcasting as a community service of the University of Hartford. This is WWUH West Hartford, WAPJ Torrington, WDJW Summers, and WWEB Wallingford. And now back to Connecticut Radio Memories. The 1230 spot on the AM dial in Hartford, occupied from 1936 to 1954 by the Hartford Times radio station, WTHT, lay dormant for years. Then in 1958, a new station came on in Manchester, Connecticut.
In my hometown of Manchester.
Sean Edenburn.
There was a radio station by the call letters of WINF.
WINF for information.
Chuck Crouse.
WINF, licensed to Manchester, but was a Hartford station.
They were on West Middle Turnpike in a shopping center, and the transmitter was on Love Lane.
Bryant Thomas.
And that was my first real commercial radio station in terms of a station that was a CBS affiliate for openers. And it had very contemporary hosts on it. They weren't really disc jockeys, but they were hosts. And it was a middle-of-the-road music. And what they did do, which was interesting, was the weekday hosts recorded these voice tracks that, you know, I would go in and play on the weekend. And it would be like they were doing a show because the voice tracks were like little nondescript bits that they would put on the air between records and between commercials. So it sounded like the weekday host was there, but he really wasn't. And then, of course, the commercials would go in and out, and the news would go in and out, and the jingles would go in and out, and the weather forecast. It sounded just like there was somebody there talking, except it was all canned.
So they were kind of ahead of their time, right? Because that's really common today.
That's right. It was the type of operation where you could learn a lot because there were a lot of good people there. Dick Beach was there, for instance. He's a guy that went up to work at WGY in Schenectady after he got done with INF. And Dick was a wonderful seasoned broadcaster. A lot of people at INF that were really good at what they did. Unfortunately, the station only had 1,000-watt signal output at 1230 on the dial, and at night it only had 250 watts.
The station had only a limited coverage.
So you really couldn't get the thing except halfway down Love Lane in Manchester at night.
Again, Chuck Crouse.
At nighttime, from the transmitter in actually East Hartford, not actually Manchester, our signal kind of got about as far as Quaker Lane in West Hartford. We did not even cover all of West Hartford.
You might get it on a good car radio in East Hartford, but certainly not in Hartford itself.
So it really didn't cover the region.
That's right. It really didn't cover the area at night. The metro was a forgotten thing at night.
But we got Hartford, Windsor, Glastonbury, Rocky Hill, and the communities along the east side of the river.
During the day, it was, you know, not so bad. But at night, it was just dreadful.
WTIC had a program called Mike Lime. DRC had a once-a-week newsmakers program called Hot Seat. POP had a late-evening talk show that both Ed Clancy and Bob Paiva, he did a talk show. But what united them is they were all short programs, half an hour or perhaps an hour. And in many cases, the host set a topic, and it wasn't a wide-open sort of thing. When Sidney Walton bought the radio station, in Manchester.
Sidney Walton owned them, and he was a retired CBS guy.
And he adopted the talk format. He was a newscaster by profession. He had been a newscaster for WOR in New York and for the Mutual Network. And so I think he was naturally inclined to do it. And he had bought this station in Manchester. He lived in West Hartford. He was a rather self-important person and rather peremptory in his manner. Not nasty. It was just sort of, you need to know that I am an important person and I am a success. And he owned this talk station, and he wasn't in the station very often. And so here he was, you know, trying to control a very difficult-to-control format. Also, when you were doing talk, you didn't have to pay music royalties to ASCAP and BMI because we never played music. So that meant he didn't have to shell out 6% of his revenue for the rights to play music. The thing about that is we were talk from sign-on to sign-off, and each talk show host pulled a shift, but the overall program from morning to night was called Speak Up Greater Hartford.
It is 23 before 2 o'clock on WINF, the Speak Up Greater Hartford show.
That served two purposes. One, it gave a unifying name to what we did, but also it got the name Hartford in, since the station was really in Manchester.
And I had a call 6 months out of college, and they were looking for a talk show person at the old WINF, which was an AM station then in Manchester, Connecticut. Now, subsequently, I believe, a Hispanic station here in Hartford at 12:30 on the dial.
Bob Dunn.
And got that job and did mornings, and it was all local talk. That would have been 1968. But at one point, I guess the most fun I had, Joey Reynolds wound up doing a stint there, and I acted as his producer for his show, and that's how I got to know Joey.
Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome in to Speak Up Greater Hartford with Joey Reynolds. A reminder that the opinions on this program are those of Joey and those of you who call in at 278-1900. They are not necessarily the opinions of the staff, the management, or the sponsors of WINF. This afternoon, starting at 2:10, Joey will have as his guest Andrew Gale, who is a farmer. And for the next hour, as is always, Joey will have his warm-up. And now, without any further ado, here's an empty chair. Joey's number is 278-1900. Without any further ado, without any further ado, you've already been introduced four times.
Are you serious? Have I really? You really have introduced me four times? Bob, tell the truth. I was only in the hall. I was what they call rapping. You know what rapping is? I know a lot of you women do it at Christmas time. I was Reynolds rapping. No, that doesn't mean putting anything in tinfoil. It means conversing. To have a rapport with someone, see? That's where the word comes from. So I was rapping. I told you about those hip words. I warned you. But today we're going to have a witty, urbane farmer. I didn't know he was a star. I thought he was run-of-the-mill. Anyway, he's going to be on the show today. We're going to have a farmer on the program. And did Dennis have a serious show today? He had a serious guest from communications, huh? And usually we have to follow Dennis's show with Dennis's attitude. He's usually either very serious or gets everybody enraged, and they're so angry by the time they reach the phone, they want to choke me with the cord. This is like following, the Naked City. I can just see it on primetime television, right? And now we leave the assassination news to bring you the Joey Reynolds Show.
Right, it's got to be something really serious. Every day, friends. All right, I'd like to talk about a couple of things today, which is a pretty good idea on an all-talk station, friends. I was going to play my flute, but would you like me to play some music today? Yeah, what would you like to hear? How about the Sidney Walton Third Movement? That's a hot selection around here. We're just having a discussion about radio or the news, which is a very interesting thing to talk about. It's a very good place to talk about radio, too, on the radio, right? We're talking to Jack Raymond, who's on in the evening, and he asked my advice on what to do on radio. It was pretty amusing. That's like asking Barry Goldwater how to become president, you know?
Again, Bob Dunn.
I can remember Saturday afternoons like this, actually, because I often worked Saturdays, and the station was affiliated with the Mutual Radio Network. And the last newscast that you would get on a Saturday afternoon back then for Mutual was at 12 o'clock, and my shift ran until 6, when I'd be replaced by the nighttime person. So I'd actually go from 12:05 on this little 1,000-watt AM radio station in Manchester to 6 p.m. and with very limited phone calls, a light commercial load. And so I remember bringing in as many books on astrology or anything that I thought might be of interest to generate phone calls. But that's a long shift without a break for news or traffic or weather or sports. And I particularly remember that.
Again, Chuck Crouse.
At the time I went to work there, the morning talk show host was named Jeff Riggs. He was young, in his 20s. He was very thoughtful and related very well to people. He had very little ego, and he had just a very nice voice. The midday guy was Terry... can't think of Terry's last name right now. There was a guy named Dennis Richards in the early afternoon who was rather flamboyant. Late afternoon from 4 to 6, a guy named Gerald Strouch called himself Uncle Jay, and it was a very flamboyant show.
It was Uncle Jay, Jerry Strouch. I've lost touch with him over all of these years, but a real hustler and a comedian kind of guy. And
he created an Uncle Jay character, and for the time, it was pretty outrageous and pushed the envelope pretty hard. By today's standards, he wasn't all that. He didn't rise to the level of an Imus or a Grease Man or anybody like that, but he was kind of the premier personality of the station, and 4 to 6 in the afternoon, you had a lot of people driving home. Eventually, Dennis Richards left, and I got the 2 until 4 block. So for something over a year, I did talk shows for 5 hours a day, 2 hours in the afternoon from 2 until 4, and then from 9 until midnight. I also was on the board from 6 until 9 while other people were doing sports and some other things. But 5 hours a day of telephone talk during the middle of the Vietnam War and things like that was very demanding, because we're on the air live, and I do mean live. WINF did not have a tape delay. We were on the air, absolutely live, and there was nothing to protect the station but the talk show host's alertness and the speed with which he could operate the pot that would take a caller off the air, the knob on the control board. And I'm proud to say that the whole time I was there, nobody ever snuck anything on the air. Every now and then you could tell that somebody was kind of working up to something. And the only way we had of screening the calls was that the calls came in through a speakerphone on the desk. And what we would do is we would punch up the caller on the speakerphone, but the telephone would be turned down on the control board. And we would say, hi, you're on the air on WINF. And on the strength of the first couple of words we heard on this little speaker, we would decide whether to put them on the air or not. And 99% of the time, they sounded okay, and we'd bring up the pot. So the listeners on the radio never heard the first couple of words of the caller. They would hear the caller kind of coming up partway through the first sentence. And that was our way of screening them. There's no other person in the studio with us. There was one demented person who tried day and night for months and months to try to swear at us on the air. And they tried to get the big F word on the air, but they had an unusual voice, and they would holler this so quickly that we would hear it on the speakerphone, but it didn't get on the air. And we just punch to the next line and bring up the next caller. So this person had the frustration of however many times a day they tried of never getting on the air. You see why I think the person was pretty demented. As for the regular callers, if you noticed that a caller was getting kind of exercised and, you know, getting worked up and you're kind of getting on the edge of letting some inappropriate language on, we would simply say, remember now, you're on the air. And they'd usually apologize and, you know, continue their conversation. Okay. Every once in a while, someone would get a little feisty about it as well. Who tells you? And our answer would be, my job is to push the button. We were making sure that nothing got on the air. But it was just that quick response that protected the station.
Now, when you were a talk show host at WINF, were you expected to have an opinion, or were you more or less just the moderator?
No, I was a moderator, and that was my decision. I was already known in the market through having been on the air as a newscaster, and if I ever spoke of my coming at a topic from a point of view, it was from a journalist's point of view. And I did not see my job, and I'm sure Sidney Walton did not see my job, as selling my own agenda, whatever it might be. I was there to draw out the listener. If we weren't getting very much in the way of calls, or we were getting calls on a particular side of something, I would try to provoke, but I don't want to overstress that word, to invite people to contribute. So if people were calling on one side of an issue, I'd try to see if anyone from another point of view wanted to contribute. WINF had an affiliation with the CBS radio network, and we didn't really have a news department. I had the title news director, but I was carrying 5 hours a day on the air, so I didn't go out and cover much news. I would write news for myself and for others, but mostly it was ripped off the wire. We would carry a network newscast, and then we'd do 5 minutes of local news, and then the talk show would begin at, well, in those days, the CBS newscast was, I believe it was 6 minutes long, and then we'd do 5 minutes of local news. So 11 after we'd get on with the talk show. The last CBS newscast of the night in those days was 10 o'clock. So from 10 o'clock until 12, my mic was hot the whole time, which made it necessary when I had to get to the bathroom to do everything I had to do during a 60-second public service announcement. And that usually worked, but not always. And, you know, I get back into the control room as quickly as I can, and we had a lot of regular callers, and sometimes a caller would say, you were away from the microphone. I said, yes, I was, and then just on we go. During most hours, we did pretty well with callers. We had some regulars, and some of them would call, you know, a couple of times a day, and we would know from the voices, the regulars, and we'd let them go. You know, if they wanted to talk for 10 minutes, that's fine. If nobody was calling on the other line, why tell them, well, I got to go, and then just fill time. Every now and then, we would get unsigned letters. They were a little scary. We would get unsigned letters from people accusing us of being communists. I've kept a couple of them as souvenirs over the years, and I'm sorry, they were unbalanced people, if you go by the letters. They would accuse us of, you know, all kinds of things, but basically foisting a liberal or communist point of view, that we hated America. They even, one of them said CBS, Communist Broadcasting System. Either they wouldn't be signed, or in one case, it was signed G.I. Joe, and they were not rational letters. If somebody wanted to take issue with me on something, and once in a while they would, a thoughtful person would point out what I'd said that they disagreed with, explain why they disagreed, and, you know, sign the letter. And over the years, my feeling has always been, a letter that doesn't get signed doesn't get read. It might be read simply out of curiosity, but certainly not serious. If somebody brought up a good point of view in a letter or a call, I'd bring it up on the air. I'd say, somebody sent me a note the other day, and it said so-and-so, and for some reason they didn't care to call, but here's what they said, and I'll read it to you so that you can hear it. I wasn't there to be right. And I understood that if somebody made a good point in disagreeing with me, that should go on the air. And that was the policy at WINF. Imagine how all the INF talk show hosts felt in later years when the phenomenon of talk radio in the 90s and later became filled with talk show hosts who had very strong points of view, who just belabored those points of view.
In the early 1970s, WINF dropped the talk format in favor of middle-of-the-road music.
Songs by Sinatra, WINF.
1970. WINF got sold, and it was purchased by a young man from New Rochelle who had more money than common sense. Actually, he didn't have that much money either. He tossed out the talk format and made a lot of changes in programming.
Sean Edenburn.
Music, middle-of-the-road stuff, Terry Como, stuff like that, you know.
Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to Songs by Sinatra. It's presented by Groton Weagle, and I do thank them, and I thank you for being with me.
Eventually, under general manager Jeff Jacobs, WINF aggressively recruited former WTIC on-air personalities who had lost positions at TIC after their format change in 1976. Bob Ellsworth.
WINF in Manchester, because Jeff Jacobs is a wonderful, was the wonderful manager over there at the time.
And there we have it, the afternoon edition of Songs by Sinatra. You heard it here at WINF in Manchester, and we hope it's tied the week up nice and neatly for you.
I think you might call it a cozy corner,
yeah.
TIC. It was almost a recreation of TIC, because, especially when they were hiring so many of us, like George Ehrlich was their sports director. Right. So I followed Gene Colbert's show every day on WINF when we were all freelancing at that point. You know, our prior service at WTIC was, you know, gave us enough momentum to be on the air and known by most of the audience. And I would have a music show from noon till 1 every day with my own collection. And things I introduce on a semi-classic and classic basis, sort of a crash course in that in that sound. So we were all on the air, Gene and I, and so that's what's probably brought some of it home. Surprised one day when we walked out of the door, walked down the street in the Hartford, and there on the side of a bus was our images and our names.
Oh.
So, gee, they never gave us that kind of publicity at TIC. We didn't have to, right?
Though ratings increased at WINF with the new personalities, it was still hampered by INF's poor signal and consequently small coverage area. In September 1977, when the station's owners, the Charnas family, announced a format change to rock and roll, General Manager Jeff Jacobs locked the new management out in protest to keep the middle-of-the-road personality format on air. This brought nationwide attention to the station, and performers like Tony Bennett offered moral support.
Tony Bennett reminding you that this is WINF Manchester, Greater Hartford's home of good music.
I left my heart in San Francisco.
Good afternoon, everybody. Program number 1. Tony Bennett sings. Welcome to our show. You'll be hearing us weekdays from 4:15 through 4:30. This very talented singer, this human being that is so interested in the preservation of good music.
The owners relented, but in 1981, Jacobs was forced out over another format change to pop music. In 1982, the station ironically went back to the middle-of-the-road format with the so-called Music of Your Life format. Again, Bryant Thomas.
With the advent of FM, of course, all these AMs started to fight for their lives, and, you know, INF was one of the first casualties.
In 1984, the station was sold again, and call letters changed to WKHT for its contemporary country music format. This format remained for a few years. FCC records show several call letter changes after that. For a brief period in 1989, it was WFNS, a financial news service that was paired with WFNW 1380 in Naugatuck. Later that year, it became a Spanish-language station, WLVH AM. In 1991, its call letters changed to WLAT. In 2001, it became WNEZ. From 2004 to 2007, it was WKND. Then in 2007, it went back to WNEZ. While many full-service hometown radio stations have gone away, there are some that have survived and thrived because of their emphasis on serving their local communities. One of these is WILI.
WILI in Willimantic, Connecticut.
started in 1957.
It first went on the air in 1957.
Mike Rice.
That was before my mother and father owned it. My father rose to the ranks of a vice president with the Mutual Network in New York.
Longtime WILI morning man, Wayne Norman.
He became quite a broadcasting mogul himself. He was involved with Mutual Radio in New York, and we have a picture on our website of him with Bing Crosby. I mean, and he was the guy that gave Don Knotts his first commercial job, you know, Barney Fife. He was also one of the people instrumental in getting Buffalo Bob Smith on the air. He's got quite a track record.
Again, Mike Rice.
And then retired from that in the 1950s to purchase his own radio station.
But he really wanted to get the family involved in basically a community-run radio station. So they bought this station here from the prior owners.
They bought it in 1959 and ran it from that point on. And my mother ran the office and my father ran the sales and the management side of the business. And I joined the station in 1965.
Again, Wayne Norman.
And most of the Rice family that was involved back then is still involved now. Now, Herb passed away 20 years ago, but his sons, Mike and Colin, have been actively involved in this place. Mike just retired at the time the sale went through back in 2005. Colin is still here as a vice president. Herb Rice's daughter, Robin, is a traffic manager, and she's been here for over 30 years. And even a second generation beyond that, Keith Rice, who is Colin's son, has done quite a bit of air work for us, mostly on the FM, but also on the AM as well. So the Rice family still stays involved.
Again, Mike Rice.
It was extremely local. There was a music component to it, I guess what you'd call a top 40 or current hit music of the time, with an awful lot of local news and sports, both news on sports and sports play-by-play. A lot of specialty programs on the weekends, some of them foreign language programs. The station just did everything it possibly could do to serve the Willimantic Windham area with every possible type of local live programming. Of course, back then, everything was live.
This is WILI Willimantic Radio 14.
With the news that is happening.
It's 2 o'clock, time for news from Connecticut's number one radio news center. Your reporter, James Duffy. Good afternoon, James.
Good afternoon, Nick. The Eagleville Dam bill has passed the State House of Representatives just moments ago. The bill cites the renovation and remodeling of 12 acres around the dam for recreational purposes. Last Friday, the bill passed through the Senate.
We had a news director named Les Douglas. He worked a split shift. He came in probably 5:30, 5 o'clock in the morning, got the news ready for the morning shift, and did news on the half hour, probably till around 10 a.m. Then took a little break, came back and did the news at noon. At noon, the news ran from noon to 12:30. It was a half hour report. And then he would take a little time off in the afternoon, come back late in the afternoon, do the news and PM drive, and then go out in the evening and go to the town meetings and whatever was going on, and tape record things that could be played back in the news the next day. So it was a brutal shift, but back in those days, that's the way the job was done. And the music pretty much was used as an interlude between various forms of information programming. Our competition was really the local newspaper, the Willimantic Chronicle, and not other radio stations. Their competition was for on the news side, of course. Everybody wanted to be first with the various news stories, and also in the sale of advertising, which, of course, supports everything that we did.
Again, Wayne Norman.
WADS in Ansonia. And that's where I was working in summer of 1970 when Dave Evan, who was the general manager at WILI, probably at that time his program director, who was another WHUS guy who I knew from UConn, which is why he knew to call me. He gave me a buzz and offered me a job, gave me more money I was making in Ansonia, and 37 years later, I'm still doing it.
Again, Mike Rice.
There's a fellow named Ed Reed. He did PM Drive, and I believe he was originally from the Norwich area, but came to WILI, I would say, in the early 60s and was probably at the station through the 60s and was a very popular disc jockey. A fellow named Bill Oles was the sports director. He did long-form sports news programs morning, noon, and evening, and also did the play-by-play of high school football and basketball, and I don't believe we carried any any UConn sports back in those days. That was something that was the purview of WTIC in Hartford, so we stuck pretty much to the local high school sports.
Bob Gregory. Bob went on to become one of the big shots with the Milford Chamber of Commerce. He's still working down there now, but he was an extremely popular jock here. That was also in the 60s.
Hi there, and welcome to the happy sound of the Happy W. This is Uncle Greg here with you this afternoon, and we have something special for you this Tuesday, November 14th, 1967. Actually, a great deal of this show is going to be taped. And that tape is going to be sent to Specialist 4 Stephen Arashina, who is on duty in Vietnam at Cameron Bay. He wrote WILI a letter and asked if we had any of the current songs that are going around now, because they have some, but he said they were old, you know, and he'd like to find out what's new and what's right now in pop music. So we are going to take this show and send it to Steve Arashina, and with our best wishes. So it's kind of a special show, really devoted and dedicated to one guy, representing all the guys over there, and we hope that they'll get some enjoyment out of it, as well as you, as we go along this afternoon. This is a new one by the Fifth Dimension, and it's doing very well. It's called Paper Cup.
Again, Wayne Norman.
On the interview with the 60s jocks, which was Mike Girardi, begins with a jingle. And it's, hey, folks, we're all set to go for the Mike Girardi show. Da, 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 da. And the jingle goes on for like 30 seconds. And then it's got a music bed for 30 more. And that's when Mike would come on live and say, hey, everybody, we're here today. We've got this, that, and the other coming up. And so I played the jingle live on the air for our 50th anniversary with Mike in the studio. And with no prep or no second thought at all, he just launched into one of his usual little bits that he would do starting his radio show about what he's going to do, what he's going to play, and what he's going to say, and things like that.
Hi, friends. We're all set to go with the Mike Girardi Show. Here's music in your favorite style and 1400 on your dial. It's time for music and fun. It's time for everyone to join in. We're set to go with the Mike Girardi Show.
Hi, everybody. It's Mike G, the Bumblebee, buzzing your way between now and 7 o'clock tonight. 9 full hours of the music you love. Elvis, the Beatles, Bobby Rydell. Everybody's on the show today, so please stay with us. We're going to have a great time, and we've got things to give away right here on WILI Radio 14 Willimantic.
9 hours? You did a 9-hour radio show?
That was my short day. That was my short day.
Oh, jeez.
It was hilarious. It was just so classic, you know, 50s and 60s radio.
Again, Mike Rice.
All these stations have classic stories, and we have one, and this is it. I would guess this would be in the 1960s. We had the traditional station Christmas party at the home of one of the employees. I'm not quite sure whose home it was, but it was Saturday night party, and it was a late night, a good, very good party. And the program director and station manager at that time, it was his job to come in on Sunday morning and put the station on the air and do some Sunday morning programming, and also get everything up and running for some of the foreign language programming that came on throughout the day on Sunday. Well, the fellow that was whose job this was came in to do it on Sunday morning, and he was not feeling too well due to the party the night before, and he actually fell asleep. Fell asleep while the station was on the air, and the music that we were playing records at that time, and the particular piece of music he had on got to the end of the record and started clicking, as a record would do when there's no more tracks left to play. And another employee heard this and called my father at home and said, do you know that the station is on the air, but nothing's happening? So my father, who knew absolutely nothing about equipment, he was not a technical type, did the only thing he could do. He got in the car, drove to the station. He only lived about 5 minutes away. Got to the station, went inside, sat down before the control board, and tried to get himself on the air. My father didn't know how to run the control board. Finally, he figured out how to turn the microphone on and ended up just reading anything he could lay his hands on to keep something happening on the air. He didn't know how to play music, so he's reading anything that he could lay his hands on to make something happen until someone would come and get him, and also dropping hints on the air that someone someone better get down here because we need help. And eventually someone did and bailed them out. And the 98.3 frequency was applied for the city of Willimantic in about 1972, I'd say. We were applicants at the time, as were broadcasters from Windsor, Connecticut. And in those days, the FCC was very particular about the same company owning the AM and FM station in the same community. So because there were two applicants for one frequency, it went to a hearing, and we lost, and the people from Windsor won. And the reason we lost was because we already owned the AM station in town. So the people from Windsor put the station on the air, and at first it was called WXLS. That was their first call letters, and it went on the air in 1974, and the people from Windsor ran it, I would guess, till somewhere around 1978, and then they sold it to a different group. They were from Hartford, and they changed the call letters to WNOU, and they ran it until 1984.
It went through, I believe, four different sets of owners and two sets of call letters before the fourth owner eventually made the place go dark. In other words, they were non-viable economically, and they just gave up.
And at that point, they were not successful on the business side and went into bankruptcy.
At that point, the FCC raised the white flag, and they just said, okay, you guys can have it.
And we were able to buy the station out of bankruptcy and put it on the air as WILI-FM in 1985. That was back in the days when a lot of companies were tempted to put the same programming on both AM and FM, and we felt that was a sure way to kill the AM station, because if you put the same programming on both stations, people are going to tend to listen to the FM side before they listen to the AM side. So we wanted the two stations to grow and to grow separately with different formats serving different audiences, and it worked out quite well. To this day, that's still how it operates.
Wayne Norman, besides being the WILI morning man for decades, is Grand Marshal of WILI's Boombox Parade every July 4th.
We call it the largest parade of its kind in the world. Yes, right here in little old Willimantic, Connecticut. But ironically, while I get a lot of attention and a lot of praise for that parade, initially I was one of the naysayers, which I laugh at now, but it didn't seem like it was going to work. How it came about was this longtime fife and drum corps woman who's a big-time parade person. They lost their marching band, the Windham High Marching Band, for the Memorial Day parade, like 2 or 3 days before. She comes up to us and says, hey, could you guys like play the music on the radio, and we'll tell people to bring radios, and that could supply the music. And we looked at it like she had two heads and says, no, we couldn't get it together in time, which is probably accurate given the short turnaround time. And we thought it was over. Now, that was back in Memorial Day 86. A couple of days later, probably less than a week, she came to us and said, okay, you want more time? How about the 4th of July? So we sat down and had serious talks, and we had weekly long organizational meetings as far as publicity, as far as police, as far as marshaling the parade, who's going to be in what order, things like that. And what really helped it along was somehow an AP writer happened to be in town. She was across the street at the sporting goods store, Nassif's, and she caught wind of it. She was so interested in the concept, she actually came to the meetings, and she wrote in advance a preview of the parade on a national AP wire, and it got picked up all over the country. And then she came to the parade, and she wrote a story afterwards. Not only did that story get picked up all over the country, I got people telling me they saw it in Florida and California and Colorado, but I have a newspaper story right here 2 feet from where I'm sitting in my office right now of that AP story that was translated into Spanish and run in a newspaper in Guatemala. With all the preparation we had for that parade, I drove by the formation area 2 hours before it was to start. It was 9 o'clock, the parade time was 11, and there was nobody there. And I said, wasn't this a good idea? Well, they did show up, and that first parade went 44 minutes from start to finish, and we considered it to be a hit. A lot of people did strange things that first year, and after that first year, people see what other people do, and now it's a real expression of freedom, a real expression of independence, which is even more appropriate for July 4th than it would be on Memorial Day.
Again, Mike Rice.
There are a lot fewer stations that are owned by small companies and families locally, the way my mother and father own WILI. There are just very few of those kinds of operations left. But the reason that happened doesn't really focus on consolidation. Local small market radio was having trouble long before consolidation, and at least long before the consolidation of radio. And what was plaguing small market operations, especially AMs, consolidation of the advertisers and the beginnings of the large big box discounters and the shopping malls, and the fact when those things started to come in the 70s and 80s, they killed off the small downtown Main Street merchant who were loyal advertisers and really paid the freight for a lot of these small market stations to exist and to be profitable. It was that consolidation, the consolidation of the advertisers, if you will, that I think made the biggest single change in local radio and made it that much harder for local operations to make a buck. And to a certain degree, that's going on to this day. And the consolidation of broadcasting, to a certain degree, was a response to that. And it brought in the big companies, the CBSs, the Clear Channels, the Citadels, and all that, and allowed them to ratchet up to a level where they had the clout, if you will, to call on and sell advertising to these large consolidated advertisers and bring them back into radio. So the way the ownership of the station was set up, it was held in a family trust. That trust sunsetted in 2005, and it required the selling of the radio stations because of other family interests. I come from a large family, and not all of us worked in the business, but the ones who didn't work in the business still had a share of ownership. So in order for that to be settled, the stations had to be sold in 2005, so I was able to find an excellent buyer for the stations, Hale Communications, which happens to own the stations in Norwich and New London and other parts of the country.
The key part about the sale to Hale Communications, which already had owned stations in New London and Norwich, Connecticut, they basically wanted to keep the radio station operating the same way that it was, the same community thing with solid news and sports and community involvement, you know, local remotes. In other words, not going all satellite.
But they're a small market family operation, and they purchased WILI AM and FM, and that deal closed on September 1st of 2005. And at that point, I retired, but all the other employees, including some of my family members, remained and remain to this day as employees of Hale and continue to operate WILI AM and FM in exactly the same way that they were operated when we owned them.
They've basically kept it, as far as the listeners are concerned, almost sounding identical to what it was back in the 30 or so years that Herb Rice ran the place, or at least the Rice family ran the place.
Another station with a long history of serving its community is 1150 AM in Middletown, originally WCNX, and now known as WMRD.
WCNX in Middletown.
WCNX.
WCNX operates on 1150 kilohertz with a power of 1,000 watts.
Ed Henry.
When I found out that Bill and Dick O'Brien, who were planning on opening a station in Middletown, I understood that they were going to go half and half with the Middletown Press. So I found out they were having a meeting one Saturday, and I went to the Middletown Press and wanted to talk to either Bill or Dick O'Brien. And I did talk, I believe it was to Bill O'Brien, and he said, well, what can we do for you? And I says, well, I want to put in an application for a job. And he says, the station isn't even built yet. I says, I know that, but if you do build it, I hope that you'll take my application, and maybe I would love to work for you people, because I always wanted to work in radio.
I think it officially opened or went on the air in 1948.
They went on the air, I believe it was December 10th of 1948.
Bill Glynn.
At that particular time, the station was owned by the O'Brien brothers and also owned by the Middletown Press, the local newspaper. The station was pretty much run by the O'Brien brothers. Mm-hmm. The newspaper figured, look, that's your business. You run that, and we'll run the newspaper. And, you know, it worked out well. So what happened, I think three or four times a day, the local news would be provided to us by the Middletown Press. They would have someone bring the news up. We'd go through it, and you have your pretty local coverage that way. Then, of course, you'd do your own coverage, calling your police before the noontime newscast and calling the fire department, all the local people in regard to either police or fire departments, and get the information from them about any accidents or fires.
Again, Ed Henry.
I used to have a regular job. I used to get out of the job at 3:30. At 4 o'clock, I'd be at the station, and I would stay there until they closed or went off the air for the day. During the winter months, it was like 4:15 or something like that. But the first year, they were on the air till 9 o'clock. And then after a while, I start doing a little bit of news, and then there was a program director by the name of Lou Brooks who said, well, you know, you've been around here long enough, and so they had a Polish Melody show, and this was on Sunday at 10:30. So I finally did that, and then after I did that, and was there for 2 years, he finally says, well, I think you've been here long enough. You got to start working the regular shift, you know. And I didn't work the regular shift because I didn't want to quit my other job because I had a wife and two kids to support and a house to pay for. And unfortunately, radio doesn't pay that well. So I stayed there part-time, and I've been there ever since at the same station.
Again, Bill Glynn.
Many people told me one of the things they enjoyed about the Middletown station when I was there full time was pretty much the music that we played and the local news. I enjoyed the type of music they played. They played a lot of the great bands, you know, Benny Goodman, Miller, Gordman, and so forth. And I tuned in one day and didn't hear the regular announcer on that afternoon shift. In fact, it went a few days, and I think Lou Brooks, the program director, was filling in. So I figured, well, look, I had gone to radio school. I had nothing to lose. I took the bus down to Middletown, had an audition. And a couple of days later, they called up and said, Bill, you got the job. And I started off there, the last man on the totem pole, and eventually worked up to a program director later on. In 1951, you were hitting pretty much all the popular music, whether it be the big bands. The vocalists were coming on strong then. The vocal groups were coming on strong. And everything was mixed up pretty well. The boss had a regular format we had to follow. You had to make sure that every hour you'd start off following the newscast on the hour with what we call an instrumental that would move. In other words, something really swingy by the Goodman Band, Dorsey, any of the big bands. And you'd follow a routine of, you'd put the instrumental, then you'd have a male vocalist.
No, it's just on the street where you live.
Female vocalist.
Fly me to the moon and let me play among the stars.
Vocal group.
It's a woman's world when she's in love.
And follow that routine pretty much through it.
Well, on Sunday, we always had all kind of ethnic programs. We would have polka shows, and I would do that. They would have a Jewish show, an Irish show, and an Italian show.
You'd have your, you know, your Polish program and your Italian program, different ethnic groups. They would be pretty much covered.
I remember a couple of times we had this Italian gentleman who used to do the show on Sunday. He was on at 8 o'clock, and Bill O'Brien, who was the CEO of the station, I called him one Sunday because this particular gentleman didn't come in. And I says, Bill, we got a problem here. I says, the gentleman, and I forget his name now, I says, is not coming in, and I think he's through doing the program. So I says, what do we do now? And he says, well, you do it. So it was kind of exciting for me, even though I didn't know Italian, but I had a very good friend of mine that I saw often, and his first name is Benny Grosso, I believe. He's still in Middletown, as far as I know. He used to come up and coach me and tell me what to say, you know, how to sign off in Italian, how to greet the people and all that. And I used to kid him and say, Ben, if you say something that I'm not supposed to say and the FCC gets after me and locks me up, I'm going to tell him you told me to say that, you know? So we made a big joke out of it. And before I knew it, 12 years went by.
And you'd have your religious groups. You'd be broadcasting from some of the churches, like on Sunday morning, or maybe if there was an activity going on. In Middletown, at St. Sebastian's Church, which is the large Italian church in Middletown, every year they have the Feast of St. Sebastian, which goes on for a long weekend, and you'd cover that, broadcast the parades downtown. It was pretty active locally. We had four regular disc jockeys working the four-hour shift, in the morning 6 to 10, then 10 to 2, 2 to 6, and then 6 to 10, whatever it may be. And we had a big staff. We had about 14 or 15 people at that particular time. There's a great change now in the radio business. So many programs come in on a satellite. They have so many talk shows. You just don't need the personnel you had back in those days. But we had a big staff.
The station, when it was first built, was on the corner of Main and Washington Street in Middletown, upstairs.
Located right in downtown Middletown, at the corner of Main and Washington Street, a big area. It had a really fine location right in the middle of town, and the layout of the station was perfect, a lot size compared to what we have in most stations today. And it was very difficult, especially in the summertime, because we didn't have air conditioning, and it was very difficult for working in the control room because we had an exhaust fan that was supposed to bring in fresh air to the control room. But the trailer trucks going by, you know how high their mufflers are. Sometimes some of that carbon dioxide would work its way into our studio. And so we used to have another fan to blow things out and clear the control room, especially the control room, because of the heat from the turntables and so on. And they were there for quite a while until they moved, I guess, in the late 50s or early 60s out to their current location on River Road along the Connecticut River, which is a nice location too. Now, when they first got the license for that station, it was a daytime station, which meant during, in other words, now in the month of December, you'd have to sign off the air at 4:15. And the time would vary depending on sunset and sunrise. So therefore, that changed all the time. So we came to a situation where the station was becoming greatly involved in local sports, which they do now. And American Legion baseball was solid in Middletown, had some solid teams. We went to the New England championships, that always outstanding teams. So what we did, signing off the air at 4:15, we had a tournament being held up in Manchester, New Hampshire. Middletown had won the state title, so they're in that about 7 or 8 team playoff. So what we decided to do was to somehow, we had to sign off the air at 4:15, so we couldn't cover the game completely if the game was starting at 7 o'clock. We passed it through and fed it into the loudspeaker system out at Palmer Field, which is a big baseball and football stadium in New York. So what we did, we broadcast out there directly on the PA system, and we had great crowds coming out there. They opened up the refreshment stand, the concession stand. Scoreboard was in operation, and everything went well. And the part was people going by there. Let's say an out-of-towner went through there. They say, gee, I saw that ballpark over there. They had people clapping and hollering and everything. The scoreboard, I couldn't see any teams on the field. They didn't realize we were broadcasting, you know, to the PA system from Manchester, New Hampshire. The engineer they had in charge of setting up that operation did a smart job. The transmitter is located out where their current station is located on River Road. And what would happen there, when the river would back up, that area would become saturated, or actually it'd be flooded, and that would really push up that signal. I'd be doing Eastern League baseball games up in Holyoke, Massachusetts, when the Bristol team would play up there. And I could listen to the station up there in Holyoke, Massachusetts. Even to this day, 1150 has a great signal.
And then I think after 25 years, the O'Briens decided that they've had enough, and so they wanted to sell.
Well, you had the O'Briens, of course, had the station till 1976.
And that's where some of the problems started. There was a man named Corey Thurston from Massachusetts who I believe owned 2 or 3 stations in Massachusetts. Very nice man.
Del Raycee.
Don Thurston owned the radio station. He bought it. He bought it from the O'Brien brothers, and he wasn't doing too well with it.
He used to come down here and try to get some of these people to buy the station, because he had the station, and after he bought the station, he realized that, gee, he got 2 or 3 up there and 1 here, and it became a little too much for him. That's where the cycle began, where we were getting 1 owner, and then they wouldn't pan out. We get another owner. That didn't pan out.
You had different ownership coming in there. You had one situation where, this was maybe 8 or 9 years ago, they decided to make it an all-day traffic station. That did not do too well. They ran it for a while and just didn't have, you know, the push that they thought they would have by going to that format.
It would be very difficult. It seemed that the sponsors we had, little by little, they would drop off, and then even I would go to some of them and say, gee, what's the problem? And they say, well, Ed, you know, it's not you. It's just that we don't know who's going to own the station next week,
yeah. You
know?
This is AM 1150 News Talk WCNX, Middletown, Hartford, New Haven.
Remember once we had a leaky roof, and I was doing the show, and when we had one of the owners, I won't mention their names, but the roof in the, at that time, the production room was leaking. And I used to sit there with an umbrella because the roof was leaking and it was dripping on like the turntable or something, and my wife used to say, you better get out of there before you get electrocuted, you know. And it's little things like that that made me just love radio. And so that was a problem. But and I think it was after something like 6 or 7 owners, we finally came along with Don DeCesare.
And Don DeCesare bought the station.
and he immediately put the station on the map. Now that Don is at the helm, I congratulate him because he's not only a very nice man. Of course, there is a little bit of a coincidence here, too, because he and I have a birthday the same day. Only his birthday coming up, he will be 61, and I will be 81. So I always kid him. I says, Don, you got to treat me right because, you know, you're getting there to where I am. And so you got to treat me right. But I think the best thing about radio is you have to use your imagination, and that makes it very, very nice. But I love to do it. I really love to do it. I mean, you go somewhere and you meet our listeners, you know, and they say, well, we listen to the program and we like it, you know, and it makes our Sunday because you're having a good time, and so we're having a good time. So that's the way it goes, and like I tell my boss, Don DeCesare, I don't think I'll ever quit there.
Middlesex. New London. Suffolk, Long Island. They know the biggest sound. On the sound. WLIS.
The biggest sound on the sound now presents Ricky Nelson and Poor You, Baby.
Rusty Potz.
Well, I did some news at WLIS in Old Saybrook very briefly.
Now stands at 40 sunny degrees.
But the WLIS news. On the world and national scene. On the Connecticut state and local scene. And the famous Lizometer. WLIS news on the hour and on the half hour.
That was really a little station at the time. That was back in 1963. Basically, what they did is they got newspaper clippings from the Hartford Current and the Middletown Press, and they'd have me read them back over the air. They were a top 40 station also.
It's more fun than a sleigh ride. The Gary Girard Wild Weekend Show.
Baby, I love you. That's the sound of the Ronettes, everybody, on the Wild Weekend Sound that's bound to get around. This is your weekend warrior, Gary Girard, right here on WLIS Radio, 1420 in Saybrook, Connecticut.
I like the weather.
WLIS in Old Saybrook.
Wayne Norman.
That is where I made my first contact with the guy that I've done a lot of those 1,000-plus UConn games, Joe D'Ambrosio. Joe at the time was working at WLIS, and he was doing sports, he was doing jock work, he was doing a lot of different things down there that I think a lot of people that work in small radio wind up having to do, which is a good thing. You learn how to do a lot of different things, and it makes you better when it comes to later in your career.
Del Raycee.
I bought WLIS, I think, in 1987. So I had LIS from 1987 to 1995. Don DeCesare bought the station, CNX, and then approached me through Don Thurston as to whether I would sell him WLIS.
Bob Muscatel.
My first and only job in radio has been WLIS and consequently WMRD when they came on board as a result of Don DeCesare buying both stations. And here I am 31 years later.
Bob Muscatel, who was a morning man, but he's been a fixture there for quite a few years.
I was never really a morning man. Everybody says to me, gee whiz, you've been doing this so long, you must be a morning kind of guy. And I really wasn't. I was actually a bit of a night owl. So getting used to the opportunity to wake up that early in the morning was just very tough for a long time. But now that I'm used to it, my body is as well, so my inner body clock just will not allow me to to sleep very late at all. Even on my days off, I'll find myself getting up at 6:30 sometimes. But it's good now that I do the morning show because it's a great opportunity to wake people up in the morning. It's the prime spot, and it also allows me, once I'm done with my duties for the day, to have the rest of the day at my fingertips. So it's kind of nice. It's really a choice position.
20 WLIS Old Saybrook.
Well, it's just tremendous. It really is. To be independent as we are and to have the owner general manager on hand, not only for his contributions, but also to help steer us in the right direction as well. It allows us to stay local, to do a lot of local remotes, to be hands-on, to do a lot of local sports, bring some of the high school games to the listeners, and you know, do some basketball, do some football. It also allows us to, as you say, be out in the community and really service the area that we were born and bred to reach. And this is the main reason why I've stayed all these years. I mean, you know, there are probably opportunities that might have been available to me, but to be in this area, an area that I grew up in and that I know so well, it's been a perfect marriage for me. And it's so great to broadcast to these people and then go out in the community after work and participate in some of the same events that we've just been talking about, you know, some of the things that are going on, sporting events, etc. It's great to live in the community that you service, and it really does free us up to be everything that we want to be in the community. It's been just a great mix.
WMRD and WLIS now simulcast the same programming.
We simulcast just about, I would say, a good 98 to 100% of the time. And so it's been great for us. The people on the shoreline, as they might progress from the shoreline into the middle part of the state and beyond, they can switch their dial from 1420 to 1150 and still stay with us. And they know that and they understand it. And it's the same on the other side. When the people from Middletown and Hartford and surrounding communities are heading down to the shoreline, they know that 1420 is there and that we simulcast. And we've got such a list listenership now, and you know, we were very concerned when the two made the marriage, but we've made it work, and I think it's been a you know, we service both areas equally well. It's all part of the Middlesex Valley, and we just have a blast with it. And whenever we do a remote, we always make sure that we let the Middletown and Hartford communities, let them know that, you know, hey, we're going to be on the shoreline this Saturday, come on down. And consequently, we let the shoreline know that, hey, we're going to be out and about this weekend up in, you know, wherever, up in Cromwell, and you should come out and be a part of it. So we've really married the two communities, and we've had a blast doing it.
This program is dedicated to those who participated in interviews but who passed away before the program was finished. Fred Swanson, Ed Henry, Richard Ward Fatherly. But they said it really loud, they said it on the air, on the radio, whoa, on the radio, whoa, on the radio, whoa, on the radio, whoa. You've been listening to Connecticut Radio Memories, Episode 8. This program was produced and edited by Brandon Camp. Thanks to everyone who participated in interviews for this series, including those whose comments didn't make it to air. Interviews were edited for time, continuity, and clarity. This series would not have been possible without the air check collectors and other people and organizations who had the foresight to save air checks, jingles, or theme songs, and who shared them with us, including Ed Bruder from ManForMars.com, Dick Bertel, Ivor Hugh, David Kaplan, Jeff Jacobs, Wayne Norman, Bruce Camp, the Boston Radio Archives. We want to send a shout out to Bill Hennessey and the bunch of old broadcasters who meet monthly to hear the Hartford Jazz Orchestra play at the Arch Street Tavern. Special thanks also to John Ramsey. Connecticut Radio Memories was produced at the studios of WWUH-FM at the University of Hartford.
You're listening to WWUH West Hartford, a community service of the University of Hartford. We also broadcast over WAPJ Torrington, WDJW Summers, and WWEB Wallingford. Streaming online at WWUH.org, where if you hit the program archive button, you can find any of the shows we've broadcast in the last 2 weeks and listen to them when it's convenient for you. Welcome to Wednesday Evening Classics. I'm your host, Michael Dolan. I'll be with you till 8 o'clock tonight, as usual. My symphony at 6, I'm going to play a symphony or two by Thomas Horan. And at the 5 o'clock hour, we'll have Edward Elgar's serenade. Benjamin Britten's serenade for tenor, horn, and string, his Opus 31. And we'll have a few other places and pieces along the way, including Massenet. We're going to start with a piano sonata by Ludwig von Beethoven. The pianist is Jonathan Biss. He's recording all of the Beethoven piano sonatas, and this is one from 2014. He's had one since then, and he's continuing on, I think, till about 2020. Piano Sonata No. 16 in G, his Opus 31, No. 1 by Jonathan Biss.